My presentation is about the person who is one of the many people in British arachnology, in European arachnology, responsible for the good networking, which Zoe mentioned, so the good relations between arachnologists are partly because of people like John Murphy, whom I'm going to talk today. Given the limits of my presentation, I won't be able to give you many details of his contributions, but the upcoming paper will include all references, from archive, illustrations, documents, and quotes. So this will be done in full content. We know very little about John Murphy. Very few biographic data exist. So we know that he was born in on 9th of February 1922. He had a sister who died a few years before him. His father was an estate gardener. I don't know his name. Mother was apparently housewife, but she was referred to as a person of high natural intelligence. It was a religious family, and they visited the church every weekend. In his childhood, he spent his childhood in a town of Trowbridge in Wiltshire, and he liked playing cricket. And cricket was his favorite sport for many, many years to come. And during the weekends, he also sang as a choir boy in a local church. He started getting his mathematical degree at Bristol University just before the Second World War, but his education was interrupted, and so he had to do his national service during the Second World War, working for a Royal Air Force headquarters as a near Harlow. As a mathematician, as a gifted mathematician, he was asked to do math calculations of a bombing raid over Germany, and as the story tells, he reported directly to the chief commander. He was rather critical of his time during the Second World War. There are some evidence coming from archive when he was mentioning the lack of at-home experimentation before bombing raids happened, but this is something we know very little about. After the Second World War, he got his mathematical education, and he went to work for the Ferry Aviation Company, where, again, as a mathematician, he was involved in designing and developing aircraft, including even jet engines. But far more importantly, in that company, he met a young woman, Frances Marie Rangham, and as who worked as a systems analyst working on missiles. Please switch off microphone, someone is talking. The legend says that then John Murphy met this young woman. He said, this is a woman for myself. And soon after, she became his wife. And then John and Francis, they created apparently one of the most famous arachnological couple. And this is a photo taken in Singapore on one of their many world trips. Francis was already an accomplished naturalist. She was also interested in birds, botany, and also she was a good amateur astronomer. And this is a famous quote coming from John himself, that he wrote in their books on Southeast Asian spiders, that Francis was the arachnologist and that I simply became an arachnologist by marriage. So, but having said that, he of course expressed it out of his modesty. Maybe he became arachnologist by marriage, but then he became one of the most important figure in the British arachnology and world arachnology in general. So in 1960, they moved to the Hampton, where John started working as a mathematics lecturer at Brunel University, and he worked there until his retirement time. And all his spare time he spent playing crickets, the sport he played for about maybe 45 years until he got an injury. And again, as a legend says, that when he got an injury playing crickets, he could not continue to play crickets. Francis said that at last he could do something more useful. And I think this is what happened. He started working with spiders properly. They started traveling worldwide, and this graph could show you that they started shortly after 1960 when they moved to Hampton, and the most intensive period of their travels was between 1970 to 1992. Then there was a decrease, of course, caused by the untimely death of Francis in 1995, and then John also was busy with completing a book on Southeast Asian spiders. Then he continued his travel almost until 2000. Their collection contains specimens from all over the world, so they were able to assemble a massive, immense collection. And you can find materials from about 72 different countries. In total, originally collection contained about 45 plus specimens. Now we have less specimens, I'll explain why. And this collection represents about 95 different families. And this map can show you where the most represented areas are, of course, of the whole Europe, including Mediterranean, North America, Kenya was visited several times, and Malaysia. Singapore and places like that. He also visited Australia and New Zealand, and all these materials are there in this collection. He identified himself almost 29,000 specimens, two species, representing more than 3,000 species. And at the time when collection was assembled, it represented about 6% of the world fauna. So I really believe that its collection is really, really important. And this is one of the major contributions he did to the world arachnology. And this collection is not just a collection. Also, it was a private collection, but it's not a collection assembled by a private person. Sometimes like lepidopteris, they collect butterflies and they consider it's like mine. No, in this case, it was a research tool, as we see later. And this research tool was accessible to any research worldwide, including myself, because I borrowed a number of times, I borrowed specimens from John Murphy collection and used them for my revisionary works. Regarding his intellectual contribution, we could say that John published about 29 papers, not about 29 papers, and three books. What is great surprise to me that he published no faunistic or alpha taxonomic papers at all. And considering that he identified almost 29,000 specimens to species, and his collection definitely contained and still contains lots of new and undescribed species, this is a real surprise. The only explanation I have that he reserved his time for far more important purposes. And these purposes were working with particular group of spiders, Gnophazidae, and also dealing with a higher taxonomy of the order Araneae. He revised about 13 different groups of Gnophazidae. Some of the publications were published together with Norman Platnik, also Anthony Russell Smith, and some others. So we could accept that John Murphy definitely was an accomplished expert on ground spiders, which is obvious from the publication of his book. He described six new genera in Gnophazidae and the family Mysminidae, but as I said, there are no description of new species, which is really, really surprising, because archive contains hundreds of illustrations, technical descriptions, and things like that, but which have never ever been published by John. The first book he published, in cooperation with his wife Frances, is an introduction to spiders of Southeast Asia. This is a very big book, 624 pages, with about 257 color photos. 40% or maybe 60% of these photos were taken by Francis during their trips. It was aimed at presenting a practical tool for beginners. And this practical tool, this is aim, was always in his mind when he was working on spiders. All his following books were also aimed as practical tools. This area also, the area of covered by this book also included 12 provinces of Southeast China, which was unusual at that time, and it's full of field observation, original field observation, and also includes some kind of ecological approach when, as a practical tool, he, for instance, presented some families, like families which could be collected in litter, in bushes, so something like that. And also, he also hoped that this book would be used by people using a hand lens, so no special equipment was required. At the end, they presented a checklist accounting for almost 4,000 species, and this is an updated checklist up to 1995, which is still used to compare against regional faunas now. The book so far has been cited 194 times. The second book that he published is a book on agnophysid genera, which is about 550 pages. It's a two-volume book. It was meant to be an atlas of agnophysida, again, a practical identification tool. And this is why agnophysida in this book were presented not in taxonomic rather than, you know, artificial way. So the identification key included characters like presence or absence of scutum, spinnerets, some sort of helicerar armament, and things like that. It became actually a world revision of genera, in which 116 known genera were illustrated, and it was only the third example of a world generic revision in the history of arachnology. It's a famous book of Levy and Levy about genera of Tiridiida, and also Rudy Jacquet published a generic revision of Zodariida. All illustrations were made by Michael Roberts, and this work was funded by John Murphy himself. I have no time to go into details now. The book received a Paolo Brignoli Award from International Society of Arachnology in 2013. And so far it was cited 95 times, but I don't think it's a real reflection of the usefulness of this book. We'll have three following presentations dealing with agnophysid family, and I'm sure colleagues will mention this book as well.
The third book, 5 minutes.
Yes, I'm nearly finished. Okay, so the third book he published is a bit more controversial. It's a book about spider families of the world. Again, quite a sizable book, as you can see, 553 pages and 327 plates. It was co-authored with Michael Roberts, who made all illustrations. Again, this book was meant to be an atlas for 115 spider families, compared, say, to 129 spider families in the World Spider Catalog. Now, the originality of this book is related to the fact that they used somatic morphology, particularly spinnerets and cuticular structure, in order to sort out families to groups. They reinstated cribellates and some other groups. And unfortunately, the book was written in a slightly provocative style, which I can explain if there is a question. With regards to taxonomy, the book provided about 73 nomenclatural changes, including description of new family, Cambridgeida, but these taxonomic changes were not included into World Spider Catalog on the ground that they were not sufficiently justified. I fully agree about this decision with regards to generic transfers, which were simply mentioned in the book without proper justification, which was strange, because in the previous book on Gnophazida, John provided very detailed justification for every synonymy or to change generic level he provided. In this book, it was not done. But with regards to families, this statement could be challenged. Again, I have no time to discuss now, but all details will be given in my paper. The book have been cited so far only 45 times. Again, I don't think it's a reflection of its usefulness and significance. And this book is cited, what is very important for me, by contemporary researchers in paleoarachnology. So this is a priceless source of morphological information on spiders. And I'm sure that as a source of this information, this book will be referred to for many, many years to come. I hope in one of the following, or maybe two following contributions, this book will be mentioned as well. And just finally, final slide, it's about spider collection. The spider collection was given to the Manchester Museum, donated in 2015. It came in original cabinets and drawers, as you can see on the illustration. All specimens are in plastic tubes, which are reliable, but we are aiming to rehouse the entire collection as soon as we can. In the last 6 years, the entire collection has been properly documented, accessioned, and all information put in our database. All specimens which were re-examined or revised, as this is, they were moved from plastic tubes to glass tubes, as an example here of the family Nemesiida. Collection contains less specimens than they originally collected. As you can see, it's about 27,800 of adults. Juveniles are not included, but the problem is that when collection came to Manchester Museum, some samples were on loan. So I still need to approach certain colleagues, hoping to get specimens back. Plus, of course, we have an archive containing almost 400 items. And I know that many specimens, including types of Naphazida, Salpicida, some other groups, they are kept in American Museum of Natural History or in Museum of Africa in Terwuren. Collection is fully accessible. If someone wants to use, of those who are listening to me, please get in touch and I'll be happy to make collection available to you. Thank you for your attention. I'd like to acknowledge the help of certain people, as you can see a list, who provided me with images or illustrations. And on the right-hand side, you can see the photograph of Manchester Museum.